Hello everyone. This is another new video lectures on. These are all another new video lectures on the subject mining machinery. As part of this video lecture, I'll be covering first chapter and the part one of it. Okay. So the following are. Let's move on. The following are the various topics which are part of chapter one of mining machinery. Mining means a subject of diploma mining engineering. Okay, like these are all the various topics. Like what are the different in this chapter, right? The main content is what you call the nose, different types of drilling machines and power loaders, and field use of each one of them. Okay, and sketch and explain the construction details of electric rotary and different parts of electric rotary drilling machine and working of electric rotary drill. Then we'll move on to what you call jackhammer drill, how exactly it will be operated, and which basically operated by means of compressed air, and what are the different parts of jackhammer drill and the function of each part of jackhammer drill. Okay, and next one is the working of vertical jackhammer drill. Next, classification of coal cutting machines. See, all these topics are going to be your part of your chapter one. Okay. So as part of what you call one, two, or three, depending on the content, coverage, right? All these topics will be covered as part of 2 to 3 video lectures. Okay. Let's see here. Next one is different types of coal cutting machines and their application. And what are the different types of power loading machines used in underground coal mines? And next, principle of working of SDL, side discharge loader. And next, principle of working of LSD. Next, principle of working of rocker shovel and the principle of working of AM50, which are used for the vertical drivage of roadways, used for longwall mining. Next, principle of working of joy continuous miner, which is of ripper type. Okay, ripper type. So these topics will be covered as part of chapter one. Okay, next, in this video lecture, out of those topics, right? In this video lecture, I'm going to cover the following topics, like what are the different classification of drilling machines? Okay. Next, construction details of electric coal drill and various parts of electric coal drill. And what are the different types of drill rods and drill bit used? And next, construction details of pneumatic coal drill and functional details of what are the various parts of the what you call a pneumatic coal drill or the jackhammer drill. And what are the functional features of it and where, how exactly each part will work. Next one, the purpose of ratchet and pawl arrangement. Next, the air leg, which is a part of what you call the pneumatic coal drill or this one compressed air operated drill or jackhammer drill. What is the purpose of air leg and its field application? Then, depending on the time availability, I'll try to cover what are the different types of coal cutting machines. Okay, so now let's move on. Coming to the classification of drilling machines, right? The classification of different types of drills. So drilling machine used in underground coal mines are classified into the following types. Okay, number one, what you call electric rotary drill or electric, it's also called electric coal drill. Okay, this is also called pneumatic drill, not exactly, just a minute. Electric rotary, this must be coal drill. What you call pneumatic, because this will be used not only in coal, it will be used in what you call a hard rock as well. So electric rotary coal drill, pneumatic drill, or it is also known as jackhammer drill, because this is being operated by means of compressed air, as the name indicates, right? Electric rotary, because it is being it will be operated by using what you call with electric power supply. Next one is the latest drilling machines that are available, like drifters, right? The drifters are used a kind of what you call the pneumatic coal drills only, but they are used what you call that to drill number of holes. I'll try to add a few diagrams so that you'll get some basic idea of this in the next video lecture. Okay, how exactly the drifter looks like, and next, what are the jumbo drills? See, basically the jumbo drills are used in metalliferous mines for drilling the holes of very large length. Like if I wanted to drill a hole of, let's say, 8 to 10 meters or 8 to 12 meters, then, the ordinary drilling machines won't be applicable. Okay, they cannot capable to drill up to that deeper length of hole. So in such situations, we'll be using jumbo drills. Okay. Now coming to the electric rotary drill. Look at here. This is a basic skeleton line diagram of electric rotary drill. In this case, if you look at here, it consists of various parts of it. If you look at the various parts of it, look at it. This is what you call electric motor. This part. Okay. Let me use one sec. This is what electric motor part of it. Kind of some synchronous motor kind of thing. This is what it is. And this is a shaft which is used for this one. This is another one. This is a kind of what? Okay, stator, rotor, because it's an induction motor. Okay. Next one, this is fan, which is basically used for cooling purpose because, you know, during operation of the motor, right, if it gets heated up, okay, for cooling of it, for that purpose, you know, we'll be using this one, the fan. Okay, this is fun for the cooling purpose. Next, this is called gearbox. See, in so many, I have seen like in many entrance examination, okay, generally we might come across these questions like, you know, which one of the following drilling machine contains what you call the gearbox? Or in case of what you call, if the drilling machine is operated by means of compressed air, right? Definitely, like it won't contain any kind of gearbox kind of thing. So, yeah, on the contrary, right? The question might be something like this. Okay, which one of the following is not a component of the what you call the jackhammer drill? So basically, it is what? Gearbox. So this is what gearbox is, which basically used depending on the step up or step down, right? Or what you call the number of teeth that are engaged or disengaged, right? Based on that, the speed will be controlled. This is called drill chuck. This is the place where the drill rod is attached because it contains what you call some slots kind of thing. If you look at here, these are all different slots or some threads kind of thing, right? So here you can, using drill chuck, right? What you call it, you can attach the drill rod to the drilling machine. That's what it is. Okay, we can attach this one. Okay, so this is motor, and here this portion. Look at here, this portion. This is where the incoming cable, because it's a slot for cable gland. So the cable will be attached to the electrical machine through this one. So basically, if you look at here, right, these are all the basic important components of electric cold drill. One is what you call the electric motor. Second one is fan, which basically meant for what you call the cooling of the motor during its operation. Next one, gearbox. Gearbox is basically used to what you call the control the speed so that we can operate the drilling machine at a varying speed depending on the hardness of the strata, like in which, you know, we wanted to drill the hole. Okay, its speed can be varied, so the variation of the speed can be done by using gearbox. Okay, next one is, there is another one that is called drill chuck. Drill chuck is basically used to what you call to attach the drill rod to the drilling machine. And the last one is what you call the cable gland, because since it is an electric motor, it requires some electric power supply, so it must contain this. This is what you call the kind of plug and socket kind of arrangement, basically where the cable can be plugged into this one, which will supply the required power supply to the motor. So that's what exactly, these are the basic components of what you call the electric rotary cold drill. So in your generally in the examination, right, you might ask a question like, you know, draw the neat diagram of electric rotary cold drill. So this is a diagram you are expected, a simple line diagram you are expected to draw. Okay, so let's discuss in detail about its construction. This one, is it the same? Okay, look at here. The following are the important components of electric cold drill. Okay, first one is number one, it's a drill chuck. Drill chuck is nothing but what? The one which is used, you know, to connect the drill rod to the drill machine, right? This is called drill chuck. Okay. Next one is gearbox. Gearbox, as I said, this portion, which is used, what you call it, to operate the drilling machine at varying speed. For that purpose, we'll be using what? The gearbox. Okay. Gearbox. Next one is cable gland, basically, you know, to give what you call the corresponding input power supply to the electric coil drill. For that purpose, now we'll be using cable gland. Cable gland. And the last one is a fan. Fan is basically, right, during operation of the what you call electric rotary drill, it gets heated up. Okay, to cool the what you call electric motor during its operation, or to cool the entire machine, right, during its operation. Okay, we'll be using fan. Fan is used to reduce the temperature of the motor, which gets heated up during its operation. So these are all the different thing. Next one, see, electric coil drill is used in to drill holes in the coal face, because basically the electric coil drill is used in to drill the number of holes near to the face. It is being used most widely used in the underground coal mines. Okay, because it's applicable mostly to drill the holes into the straw to the medium or strata. Whereas coming to the very hard strata, like electric coil drill may not be it's not applicable. That is the reason it is confined its uses only to underground coal mines. Okay, next. See here, the electric coal drills are of two types. One is CD. CD is nothing but coal drill. Coal drill of one, because you know, like differently depending on the material it makes, right? It will be having its own weight. Okay, if it is made of aluminum, definitely, as the aluminum is the light material, the weight of the drill machine will be less, because the entire machine has to be held by the worker to carry out the drilling operation, right? It has to be a kind of handheld machine, basically. So, if the machine is made of what you call the heavy metal, right? Of course, it might be robust in construction, but what happened? The weight of the what you call the drilling machine will increase, which is which requires a lot of effort by the worker, okay, to carry out the to hold it and to carry out the drilling operation. Okay, so which will increase the fatigueness of the worker. So there are two different types of depending on the material using which it has manufactured. The electric coal drills used to drill holes in coal face. Okay, they are used to drill the holes in the coal face. The electric coal drills are of two types. One is CD one, nothing but coal drill one with the steel body. CD two, coal drill two with the aluminium body. Definitely, the steel body coal drill weighs about 21 kilograms, whereas the aluminium body, because it's of light metal, right? So, whereas with the aluminium body, the coal drill weighs about 17.5 kilometers. So, there is a reduction of around roughly how much? 3.5 kgs. Okay, it reduced by that much weight. Next, the rod attached to the drilling machine by drill chuck. This is what it is, guys. Definitely, generally, you know, you might get. You'll be asked these kind of questions, like what is the purpose of drill chuck, okay, in a drilling machine. So basically the purpose of drill chuck is what? To attach the drill machine drilling rods to the drill machine. So drill rod is attached to the drilling machine by drill chuck. Okay, next, the drill rod used along with the electric coal drill are of two types, because the drill rods used, right, they're of two types. One is called diamond section drill rod. Okay, and the second one is called turbine section. Okay, I'll try to add a few more diagrams in the next video lecture. I didn't add it here, so that you'll get some more clarity on what exactly the diamond section looks like and what exactly the turbine section. Okay, I'll try to add this thing, so that you know, it makes my job simple, and at the same time it will give some sort of clear idea about what exactly these two are. See here. Diamond section drill rods, there are two types of drill rods. One is diamond section, second one is turbine section. So diamond section, it is used to carry out the drilling operation in coal. Okay, next, the drill splines, they are of what? Diamond shape. Okay, next one is turbine section. It is used to carry out the drilling operation in hard rock. So these are two different types of drill rods. Next, coming to the drill bits. Basically, look at here. The drill bits, they are very strong. They are made of tungsten carbide. So drill bits. So depending on the drill bits arrangement, okay, on the bit drill bits arrangement or the picks arrangement, so they are classified into following. See here, the drill bits used during operation of the coal drill are of two types. One is called eccentric drill bit. Second one is called concentric drill bit. Okay, eccentric drill bit is nothing but what, as this one, right, indicates what, they are scattered across. Throughout the bit, that's why they are called eccentric bit. See, if all the picks are what you call combined, you know, pointing to one single location, that is, they are called concentric drill bit. So eccentric drill bit, it is used to drill holes in coal. Eccentric drill bit is used to holes in coal. Next, coming to the concentric drill bit, it is used to drill holes through hard rock. That's what it is. It is used to drill holes through hard rock, concentric drill bit. Next, the speed of drilling machine is controlled by gearbox. This is what I told, you know, like look at here. The gearbox is used, right, basically to control the speed. So that, you know, depending on the hardness of the strata in which you are drilling the hole, right, you can vary the speed. The speed is being controlled by means of gearbox. The speed of the drilling machine is controlled by gearbox. The drilling machine operated at various speed, such as at various speeds, such as 600 RPM, these are all RPM, 500, 400 RPM in coal. And it because definitely the hardness of the speed, right, the drilling operation, right, the speed of drilling operation, right, it reduces in case of hard rock. So in case of hard rock, right, it might operate even at the speed of what? Lower speed, like 250 RPM. Okay. Next, in electric coal drill, the drilling machine, the motor used, the electric motor used is of squirrel cage induction motor. These are all very important points, okay, which you need to remember, and so that which might come in any of the entrance exams. Okay, so the type of electric coal drill used, electric motor used in electric coal drill is of squirrel cage induction motor. Next, the input voltage of drilling machine is three phase, 50 hertz, 230 volts by 120 volts AC. This is the input power supply with a motor capacity of how much? 1 kilowatts. Okay. Now, basically see here, this indicates what the input volt versus output volts. So the output volt must be how much? 120 volts. But this is very important. The capacity of the motor is 1 kilowatt. So the very important point here is, so what will be the operating voltage of the drilling machine? So the operating voltage of the drilling machine is 110 volts. It is 110 volts. Why 110 volts? Why not 120 volts? This we need to understand. What exactly is the reason behind it? See, because like whatever the vertical, out of experience, or the whatever the vertical, the field use, field usage experiences, or whatever the field conditions in which, you know, this the electric coal drill being used. Okay, the human body, even in case of shock, because it's being operated using electric power supply, right? So if it is what you call the human body, what was found, like scientifically, right, the human body, even in the event of short circuit, or even in the event of any shock to the miner or to the person holding the machine and, you know, carrying out the drilling operation, right, to any person, in the event of any shock, if the operating voltage is of about 110 volts, okay, it may not give any kind of shock, and the person can still survive even if he encounters any kind of shock, because the operating voltage is of 110 volts is such a kind of safe voltage wherein even in the event of shock the person can survive. So that is what exactly the basic, this is very, very important, that is what exactly the basic reason why the electric coal drill is being used at 110 volts. So I repeat, say why exactly? See here, if you look at here, because this concept is very important, and this is being available only in very few of the books, so I just wanted to re-emphasize this point again. Look at here, the input voltage of drilling machine is three phases, 50 hertz, 230 volts by 120 volts AC supply with motor capacity of 1 kilowatts. Okay, so here this indicates what? Input voltage is 230 volts, but the output voltage is how much? 120 volts. So definitely, generally, the machine should be operated at the output, because this is what the output I am getting, right, out of the machine. So which would be input to the drilling capacity of the drilling capacity? So which is equal to how much? It is 120 volts. But what happened here? Look at here. The operating voltage, because it's not operated at 120 volts, it will be operated at a voltage of 110 volts. It will be operated at a voltage of 110 volts. So why it is being operated at 110 volts? Because it has been scientifically proven that during operation of the drilling machine, even in what you call a wet condition, right? Even if the person encounters with any kind of shock, a person faces any kind of electric shock, okay, he will not die, he will still survive. So so it is a kind of what you call safe voltage at which you can operate in any working condition, so which will not provide any potential what you call the hazard to the person holding the machine. So it will not provide any kind of shock. So that is the reason, because at 110 volts, even the person faces the electric shock, he can still survive. He will not die. It won't lead to any kind of accident. So that's what it is. Next, the power is supplied to the drilling machine by means of flexible cable or trailing cable. Okay, in the coming chapters, we'll be discussing, okay, what exactly the flexible cable, what are the different types of cable, why flexible cable, what is the composition of vertical, how exactly it's a construction details. These things we'll be discussing in the coming chapters. Okay, so the power is being supplied to the drilling machine by means of flexible or trailing cable. Okay, which is a kind of very flexible cable, because we can keep on moving the machine frequently from one machine to another, from one location to another location. Okay, so that is the reason the cable used to supply required voltage, right? Required power supply, right? It must be a flexible one. Okay, next, the cable is attached to the drilling machine through cable gland. The cable is attached to the drilling machine through cable gland. Next, the trailing cable consists of three core phase widths. Okay, which are of, it is something like this. Look at here, trailing phase is nothing but. Let us say this is your cable, okay? And this is one core. This is another core. This is another core. This is another one. Last one is this must be. So generally it is something like what? Something like RGB, right? Okay. Basically, this is how the pilot core looks like. Like pilot core means it consists of this. Look at here. This is how the flexible cable. Oh no, this is must be black. So one second. Choose black color. Okay. So look at here. The trailing cable consists of three phases, R, Y, B. Let me look at here. These are all the three phases which are basically used for power supply. This is R. Oh, it must be yellow, right? Okay. So assume this must be of yellow color. Okay. Let's check it. So this is white. This must be blue. This must be earth continuity. So sometimes this is green, and this must be what? Pilot core. So this is what exactly what you call the trailing cable looks like. Look at here. What exactly here it is? The trailing cable consists of three core phases, like R, Y, B, three core phase wise, which are used for three phase power supply. Next, one core for earth continuity and another remaining one is for pilot core operation. So this pilot core is operated because these three wires are meant for three phase power supply. Three are meant for three phase power supply, and this is meant for earth continuity, and this is for pilot core. So here we need to understand, like, what exactly the purpose of pilot core here. So the purpose of pilot core is, because since it is being operated at a low voltage, it is being operated at a low voltage. So during operation of the drilling machine, unless until the operator holds the machine, because see here, okay, let me read out this sentence, then I'll explain. The pilot core will be operated at a low voltage, and during the operation of the drilling machine, unless and until operator holds the drilling machine in proper position and press pilot switch, then only power will be supplied to the drilling machine. Nothing but, see, what is the drilling machine that is being used, right? As I said a few minutes back, it is, the operating voltage is 110 volts instead of 120 volts, because it has been scientifically proven that human body, even in the event of shock, if a person experiences a shock, okay, experiences a shock during operation of drilling, electric shock during operation of drilling machine, he will not die, even if this he faces shock at a voltage of 110 volts. So still it makes what you call the environment safe. So that is another one. Second one is, let us say I'm using this ohm, because if you look at the working conditions nearer to the face, they are of what? Because there will be water, because to suppress the water they will keep on supplying the water. Water will be water spraying is being carried out nearer to the face, so as to suppress the dust that is being produced during drilling operation, right? So while spraying, because if you look at the working conditions, right, there it contains heat, humid, dry conditions basically. So under these conditions, like we'll be using this electric operated machine. Suppose, let us say, if a person wanted to take a break and he kept the drilling machine somewhere aside. Okay, where suppose let's say there was a power cutoff, and once the power comes, right? So it will not, supply to the machine, and it keep on operating. It kept on operation without human intervention. Okay, because it should not happen, right? Because the person kept it there, and he might be sitting here and there, which might lead to some kind of if it start operating unexpectedly, which creates unsafe environment. So the purpose of pilot core is basically unless the person holds the machine and presses the pilot core switch, the switch which is present near to the handheld grip of the machine, right? If he presses that switch, then only the power will be supplied. So for that purpose, that is called pilot switch. So the pilot switch is being operated at a very low voltage, 30 volts or 25 to 30 volts it will be operated. Okay, what are the power connection that will be provided? In that, it will be having a separate core for the pilot core operation, and the power supply given, it will be operated at a voltage of 25 volt, which is very, very low voltage. So unless until the operator presses that machine, the circuit will not be closed in the gate end panel or the drill panel. Okay, the circuit will not be closed in the gate end panel, and as a result, the power will not be supplied to the drilling machine. So what exactly the purpose of it? Look at here, the pilot core will be operated at a low voltage, and during operation of the drilling machine, unless and until operator holds the drilling machine in proper position and press pilot core pilot switch, then only power will be supplied to the drilling machine. Okay, if you hold the machine and press the pilot switch, then only the power will be supplied to the drilling machine. If you look at here, the trailing cable, it consists of total 5 crores. Out of 5 cores, right, 3 cores are used for to supply 3-phase power supply, R, Y, B, and another one is used, that is for earth continuity. The last core which is used, that is known as pilot core, which is a black in color. Sometimes in entrance examination, right, you might face, you might come across these kind of questions, like what is the color of the lead that is being used for lead that is being used as a power supply, the pilot switch, or as a pilot core. So the color of that lead is the insulation that is used. It is of what? Black in color. So that's what it is. It is operated at a low voltage. So this is about the basic construction of the trailing cable. Okay. So let's move on. Here, let me clear this. Press this one up top. Okay, now coming to the this is very important. I'll take some more time here because it requires some time for me to explain this. So this is a what you call simple line diagram of jackhammer drill. Okay, here this diagram is, I just wanted to make the diagram as simple as possible. So that is the reason I have incorporated this one here. Look at here. Let me draw this. Which is black color. Okay. This, okay. Look at here. Okay, next one. See, so your pistol. Okay, this is your Python block. Actually, it should be done. Something like this. It should be like this. Okay. This is called chuck. This is called chuck. Okay. Next here, the what is the arrangement that we have? This is called the ratchet and pawl arrangement. So this must be filled, right? Let me do one thing. Do something like this. Okay. Next, this is a piston. Okay, and this is a chuck. I just wanted to make it more clear. Right? Okay. So basically, this is what you call the jackhammer drill. So it is being operated at a it is being operated by means of compressed hay. That's why it is also known as pneumatic coal drill. It is also known as what? Pneumatic coal drill. So look at here. It consists of, these are all the basic vertical different parts of it. Let me draw a few of the components here. So these are all basically this jackhammer drill. Okay, right. So now here it consists of basically jackhammer drill is, it is being, as I said, right, it is being operated using compressed hay. So it consists of two compartments. Okay, one is called let me choose something different color here. Okay. So this portion, right, up to this, let's say half of this part, this portion is called rear compartment, and this portion is called front chamber or front compartment. This portion, okay, this is called what? Front chamber or front compartment. So this is what it is. This is the one which we are talking about. Whereas this one is called rear compartment or rear chamber or back compartment. Now what happens? So it consists of, let's look at the different parts of it. It consists of what you call, this is called rifle ball. And this is called your pistol. Okay. This is called chuck. This is where the blow is being given to the, what you call, the compressed air blow, right? That is being given on the chuck. And to which, through this only, the whatever the drill energy that is required, right, to perform the drilling operation or to make the hole, right, that is being transformed to the bottom of the hole through this drill rod. Look at here. The drill rod. It will be something like this. And then at the bottom, there will be some kind of particular drill bit here. So this is what tilde. So there the chuck, vertical the corresponding, this one, vertical the blow is being given. So it consists of two compartments. One is called the rear compartment, and another one is called what? Front compartment. And there is a rifle bar. This is called rifle bar. And this is a piston which will move like this. And this is called rifle nut. These are all called rifle nut. And this is what exactly ratchet and pawl arrangement. So, and next one is, air leg, which is used, which basically, you know, raise or lower the, what you call the jackhammer during its operation. It will be operated by means of a compressed air. This is what exactly known as throttle valve. Throttle valve, it is used to control. The compressed air that is being supplied to the drilling machine, so that we can control the speed of it. Now look at here. So first, initially, since it is being operated by means of compressed air, the air will enter into the first chamber. So where exactly it will enter? I'll take some time and I'll try to explain this. The air will enter into this chamber by means of this hose pipe. So it basically just a very simple concept here is, these are all what you call the valves basically. These two are the valves. Okay, these valves present in the front compartment as well as the rear compartment, which are meant for the supply of what you call the compressed air at a high pressure into respective compartments. Okay, so they will operate the difference of pressure that got created during the to and fro motion of the piston. First, what happens? Look at here. The air will enter like this. Air will enter into this chamber. This is also other way around. And on the other side of it, air will enter into this chamber. Okay. So once air will fill in this chamber, what happens now? It will push what you call this piston towards inside. So the piston will be moved like this. Here the high pressure will be created, right? Since initial enter, right? These valves will be closed at certain pressure, and these valves will automatically close because the pressure difference between this to this, it has increased, right? So here the air pressure is less compared to this one. So the piston will be moved forward. Okay. And while moving forward, right? Basically what happens, right? It will go up and it will give a blow. Okay. Now what happens here? See, since it is when given here, it is a low pressure, right? This is a high pressure, right? So whatever the air that was present, okay, it will come out. Through this, it will come out. The next one, what happens? The air will enter into this chamber like this. It will try to fill the front compartment. Like this, it will fill. So it will be filled. Now what happens? Here the pressure is less and here the pressure is more. So it will, which will try to push the piston toward the backward direction, like this it will. So what happens now here? What happens? It will move backward now. Since here the pressure is more, here the pressure is less. Now again, the air will start entering into this chamber. So it will fill this, and it is give a blow in the forward direction. So since the vertical this portion is being filled, the pressure of this one is more compared to this one. So it will move forward. So once it move forward, right? What happens since here the pressure is less, again the air will enter into this one, it will move backward. Okay, so since the pressure in this one again got reduced, right, then now the air will enter into this one and it will move forward. So like this, the to and fro motion will be created. Okay, which is the basic principle of operation of the jackhammer drill or pneumatic cold drill basically. So now here, during a forward stroke, right, in the front compartment, it will give a blow on the chuck. So the drill rods attached to the chuck. Okay, so to the chuck, what happens? The pneumatic energy which is used for drilling of hole, it will be transformed to the bottom of the hole through the drill rod onto the drill bit, which in turn creates the hole. Okay, so this is what exactly this one is. Next, we'll try to understand. This is called rifle bar. This is very, very important. Anyway, in the next coming slide, I'll explain in detail what exactly the rifle bar, how exactly this looks like, and what exactly the rifle nut, and what is the purpose of this ratchet and pawl arrangement. Okay, now here we have got another part that is called air leg. See, because since the weight of this machine is more, so what happens is it is very difficult to hold the machine in any required position. So in order to hold the drilling machine or to raise the drilling machine in any required position, the air leg is being used. So here the air leg, using throttle valve, right, I can control the air supply to the air, what you call the air leg, so that it can be raised or lowered. So that is what exactly it is. So the basic purpose of air leg is to hold the drilling machine in any required position, so that it reduces the, what you call, the risk of the worker to hold the drilling machine in any required position. And at the same time, it will not, some people might think like, you know, it might provide some drilling force. No, it never provides any kind of drilling force. Okay, only thing is it is used to hold the drilling machine in any required position. Okay, but it will not provide any kind of drilling force. The complete drilling force is being provided with the manual operation pushing of the drilling, what called the drilling machine. Okay, this is what exactly the basic components of what you call the line diagram, along with the basic components of jackhammer drill. Okay, let's move on. Look at here. The jackhammer drill consists of the following important components. Okay, first one is rear compartment. Second one is front compartment. Third one is rifle bar. Fourth one is, this we discussed, right? Front compartment, rear compartment, rifle bar. Next, rifle nut. Rifle nut is nothing but this one. This is called rifle nut. This portion. They are called rifle nut. Okay. So, rifle nut. Next, chuck, which we discussed. Drill rod, drill bit, air leg. So, these are all the basic components of the, what you call the jackhammer drill. Next, during operation of jackhammer drill, the compressed air enters into the drill machine. Is controlled by throttle valve. Which valve it is? Sometimes, you know, the question, same what you call the point might be asked in a different way. It's something like what? How exactly the speed of the drilling machine or speed of the what you call the jackhammer drilling machine can be controlled? So the speed of the, since it is being operated by means of compressed air, so obviously it doesn't contain any kind of what you call the gearbox. So the speed of the operation of the jackhammer drill can be controlled by throttle valve. So that's what exactly. Okay. So yeah, look at here. How I, let's look into the vertical. Let's read out. This is what exactly I have explained it. But let me read out again. The compressed air initially will enter into the rear chamber, because the back chamber, it will enter into the back chamber. This is what I was talking about. First, the air will enter into this chamber. It will enter into this. And it will be filled, so it will be moved forward. Since the pressure here is more, so what happens now? Due to pressure difference, in this chamber pressure will be less. It has given a blow. So since the pressure here is less, what happens? This valve will be closed, and this air will start entering into this one. Once this is filled, right? Pressure here is more compared to this one, so it will move backward. Okay. Since the pressure here is more, right? This valve will be closed, and air will start entering into this, and this will be move forward. So like this, you know, the pressure difference will be created between the front chamber and the rear chamber as a result, which leads to and fro motion of the piston. So this is what exactly. If you understand this, you know, rest of the what we call the points will be very simple. Look at here. The compressed air initially will enter into rear chamber. As a result, the compressed air will pushes the rifle bar, because the what exactly is the rifle bar? So, this portion. It is here, it has been very small, but it will be little bigger one, thick one. Okay, this one, which is attached to the what you call the piston, right? So this portion, so that is called rifle bar. So let me draw it just to make it more clear. Yeah. Okay, let me use a different color. So actually, the rifle bar diagram must be something like this. So this is where it should be like this. Okay, this is called rifle. This is called rifle bar. That's what exactly I was talking about. Okay, so this rifle bar, this is a to and fro motion, right? these parts are called rifle nut. This is called rifle nut, and this is another part which is called rifle nut. Okay, so now what happens? Let's move on. We'll discuss further there. We're all right. I'm just moving forward. Okay, see here. The compressed air initially will enter into the rear chamber. As a result, the compressed air will pushes the rifle bar along with the piston, pushes forward direction, which gives a blow on the chuck. Okay, next. Due to difference of pressure between the rear chamber and the front chamber, the inlet valves of the rear chamber gets closed. The back chamber will get cold because it was in high pressure. Gets closed. As a result, air will enter into the front chamber. It will enter into the front chamber. Okay. During this time, the piston will moves backward. It will comes backward direction. Okay, moves backward direction. And the splines of the rifle, because the rifle bar contains number of splines. Splines is nothing but a rifle bar. Let's say this is rifle bar, and it is attached to a piston like this. Now, what are the splines now? So it consists of some kind of like this. So these are all called splines. Like this we'll be having. So these splines will be having throughout this one. Okay. See here. Due to difference of pressure between the rear chamber and the front chamber, the inlet valves in the rear chamber gets closed. As a result, air will enter into the front chamber. So during this position, the piston will move backward, and the splines of the rifle bar, these are all called splines, will tries to enter through the rifle nut. What happens? It has to fit exactly because it contains some kind of we'll see in the next one, next diagram, rifle nut. So in order to fit the splines into the rifle bar, splines of rifle ball through the rifle nut, definitely it has to rotate a little bit, right? So that's what exactly. Let me clear this. I'll show you what I have. Yes. Look at here. Here also I don't have much. But here, this is a ratchet ball arrangement. Anyway, I'll try to incorporate that diagram. Okay. So I need to add this diagram. Okay, this I'll add in the next video lecture. We'll try to cover this. I'll try to cover this to the maximum so that I'll give some more concepts very clear. Okay, but for now, like in order to fit the splines of the rifle bar through the rifle nut, so it has to exactly pass through the grooves of the rifle nut. So the rifle bar has to rotate 1/12 of its revolution because it has to pass through that. Okay, next. This is very, very important. What is the purpose of the ratchet and pawl arrangement? So the ratchet and pawl arrangement is used to prevent the reverse direction because since the rifle bar is moving, right? So it has to rotate only in one direction. It's not like, you know, in one pass it is rotating in one direction, in another pass, right? Another blow, it is rotating in the opposite direction. So that's not a desirable feature. So basically it has to rotate every time, it has to rotate in a single direction only by 1/120th of its revolution. So basically the ratchet and pawl arrangement is used to prevent the reverse direction rotation of the rifle bar. This is very, very important question from the important point from the entrance point of view or from the examination point of view. So generally you might come across this kind of question, something like what is the purpose of ratchet and pawl arrangement in jackhammer drill? So it is basically used to prevent the reverse direction rotation of rifle bar. Okay, so look at here. Applications of various parts. Okay, rifle bar. It is where exactly it is attached? It is attached to the piston and contains the number of splines. As I said, right, it contains the number of glues. It will be operated during to and fro operation of the piston. Okay, next, rifle nut. It is used for the rotation of the rifle bar because the splines of the rifle bar during the backward motion, right, it has to exactly pass through like that. Let me see if I can draw something of exactly the rifle nut looks like. Let's see. Let's say this is one kind of thing here. Okay. splines, nothing but my diagram is, the drawing is very poor, but still I'm just trying to draw it like this. Okay, this is called refillet. This is what exactly known as refillet. This is called refillet. So the refill bar contains what? Let me draw the refill bar also here. Turn the side of it. Okay, this is rifle bar. This is the piston. It has to eat. Okay. Now what happens? This rifle bar contains number of splines like this. Let me take this. Number of grooves kind of thing. These are all called splines. Okay, now what happens? Now what happens here, these grooves, right, this has to pass through the splines of this one. This has to pass through this. So it, in order to pass this one, right, so during backward motion, it has to exactly fit into this. Now what happens, as there is, since it is not fitting into this, it will rotate something like this. So try to rotate. So since it is rotating, how much it is? 1/12 of the 1/12 of its revolution, right? Am I right? Let me see. How much it rotates? Yeah, 1/20 of its revolution. This one. 1/20 of its revolution. So it rotates like this. This one. Okay. So this is rifle nut, and this is your rifle bar, and this is your piston. So see what exactly the purpose of rifle? It is used for the rotation of the rifle bar. Okay. During backward movement of rifle bar, its splines, these are all called splines, has to pass through the rifle nut. It has to pass through this. As a result, the rifle bar will rotate by 1/12 of its revolution, 1/20 of its revolution. Okay. Next, the ratchet and ratchet and pawl arrangement. So, what exactly is the purpose of ratchet and pawl arrangement? So, it is used to prevent the reverse direction rotation of rifle bar, because every time, you know, during backward motion, as I said, right, it will be moving in the in one particular direction. So, it should not be like one pass it will move in one direction. In another pass, it is moving in a different direction. It should not happen like this. So every time it should keep on rotating only in one direction. So in order to allow the rifle bar to rotate in one direction, the rifle bar is being used. Basically, the ratchet and pawl alignment is being used. Okay, I'll clear this. Let's move on. So this is what the ratchet and pawl alignment. So what it does now? See, it will allow only. See, these are this one. Right? This is called the kind of what you call this is called ratchet. Ratchet is nothing but some kind of track kind of thing. Pawl is nothing but, these are all called pawls. What are the pawls? These are all called pawls. These are all called pawls. This portion, the one which I'm drawing, right? These are all called pawl. This is called this. Now what happens? During a rotation, right? What happens? It will allow only in the one direction rotation. So if it tries to move the other direction, what happens? These things, what are the pawls you have, right? These things will penetrate into this one so that it won't rotate it. It will allow only in one direction. It is something like what you call in case of main Halley system. If you remember, right, in case of Halley system, okay, what you call, there is at the last, to prevent the what you call the accidents due to breakage of the Halley's rope, right? Basically, at the end of the last tub, right, one rod is attached, that is called backstay. So what it does now, it will allow only the forward motion. When it tries to come back due to detachment of the rope, right, or the due to breaking of the rope, what happens? So basically, whatever the rod that is at, that is called backstay, it will penetrate into the sleepers of the track. As a result, you know, it won't cause any fatal kind of accidents, which leads to derailment of the tubs, right? In the same way here also, the pawl, whatever the pawl you have, ratchet is nothing but a kind of track. And the pawls are nothing but the kind of, what you call, the sliding levers which will moving on the track. So which will allow only in one direction. If it tries to rotate in the opposite direction, what happens? The pawls will penetrate into this one. or it will enter into this one, and which one, it never allows to rotate the rotate the rifle bar, okay, in the opposite direction. So this is what exactly the principle or the basic operation of the ratchet and pawl arrangement. Okay, so let me clear this.